Hey everyone, my name is Sam. Thanks for checking out this video. If you get to the end and like it, then subscribe, bell notification, give the video a thumbs up. This week's video, I don't know how long it's going to be, so I may end up just splitting it into the Sunday video and then the Tuesday video. I don't think I have anything I need to do on Tuesday, so maybe we'll do it that way. Last Sunday was just a bit of a mess. Saturday was kind of a mess. I didn't really have time. I went and got a car, so it just took time, and by the time I was home, the sun and everything was gone, and then it rained, like Sunday and Monday. It was just really crappy, it didn't rain, it was just hella overcast, and then it started raining the rest of the week. So I just didn't have the ability, and when I did try to start filming, my neighbor started doing his laundry, which is like literally right beside me. So it wouldn't have heard anything. So I'm going to try and condense 2 weeks of reading into this one video. But if it gets too long, it may just cut off and then watch for Tuesday's video, I guess. So first up, I started and finished Race the Sands by Sarah Beth Durst. This book was fantastic. I'm so sad it didn't come out in hardcover, at least in Canada at all. That would be a beautiful, beautiful cover to have hardcover. I may pick it up in paperback though, because I think I actually ended up liking that book more than the Queens of the Renthia series, which kind of shocked and surprised. It's so freaking good. It's got this desert setting, and everyone has their own different backgrounds which they go through, and they do all end up tying together. But the main character is, she had a really bad race season the season before, and she's a trainer, and she got this huge fine, so she's basically broke now. So she has to, or her donor basically will stop giving her money. She has to win the next, like, in the place in the top three, I think it is, in the next year's big races, like overall. Think of it as like the big NASCAR, like tournament stuff, right? Each race counts towards something, and in the end there's a big thing, I think. So she has very little money, and she needs to find a new tiger, a new rider, and they go over exactly what these tiger things are that they race and exactly how it ties into the rest of it. At first I was concerned of like, oh, are they going to be like, oh, the big reveal as to who the tiger spirit is? Because I can already tell you who it is. And I was like, this is going to be a hella boring book if that's the way they do it. But no, very quickly it was like, no, they're setting this all up so that it's other people that have to find it out. And I was like, awesome. It's not a super like, oh, we all know where this is going, this is going to be boring book. I loved the characters. There's like barely, if any, romance. The romance that there is like one character likes another character, and that's as far as it goes. Like, there's never like any like big romancing or anything like that. The main thing is like the mother character, the mother figure to her children. One is biological and one is like a child figure for her. And everything that is the backstory of that child figure, everything that is the backstory of that tiger's soul, which is explained. I know that doesn't make a ton of sense. And just everything that is required of racing. And of course, some people like to like get in the way and throw wrenches into the plans. So absolutely loved this book. Highly recommend it. Then I picked up The Midnight Queen by Sylvia Izzo Hunter. I was very unsure about this. It doesn't have a ton of like stellar ratings on Goodreads, but having read it now, I can understand why. If you are a fan of historical fictions where you're just like, I like the historical fictionness of it. I just like being somewhere else and having like the monarchy problems and like lineage problems and all that stuff. Like, it's just like a way distant, like it's not our problem, it's a very different world, right? But if you're someone who likes to read historical fictions, you're like, yeah, it's that, but I want the actions and the dragons and the betrayal, and I don't think this is for you so much. I liked the characters. It's definitely a slower paced book all the way through. There's a lineage reveal, I'm always a sucker for that being used, and I liked the main character actually quite a bit. I found the whole story really, really interesting to follow, but it's definitely not a fast one, so I can see why some people, that's just not some people's jam. So I definitely want to pick this up, actually. I feel like this would be a good like series to just kind of check out when I want to check out. So I have book two owned, so I'll watch for book one and three and keep working my way through them. Oh, I read Royals I don't know what it's called anymore, by Rachel Hawkins, because just like I've seen that book all over the place and I didn't understand. And Rachel Hawkins seems to be a pretty popular author. I read it. It was okay. It was very short. It ended abruptly in a very weird place. I don't think I'll read The Companion or whatever it was, but you know, I read it. I also read Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone as a reread. I probably will do it again. They're doing a bunch of like actors reading the chapters, and then the book was available for free via libraries and everything, so I did it that way. But I read it. It's Harry Potter. I also read The Life and Time and Medieval Times Story of Kit Sweetly. This book was really, really good, but it made me angry an awful lot. It's one of those books where I like, I've read it, I'm like, I'm glad I read it, but I don't think I ever want to have to read it again. So our main character works at the local town. I don't know if you have these anywhere else. I don't know, in Ontario, in Toronto, there's this place called Medieval Times where you go and people, like, joust, and, like, you sit down and they feed you, like, chicken and mashed potatoes and buns, and you just cheer, and then the winning knight gives, I don't know, like, I don't know, does he gives something to his court, and wherever you're sat is based on who you're just cheering for as the knight, right? I don't know if everywhere has that. We have that in Toronto. We went there for school all the time. I went there a couple years ago just because I wanted to see what it was like as an adult. Anyways, so she works as, like, the maid or, like, server, at her local Medieval Times. The place isn't doing super well. Like, business is a little, like, not great. So the franchise is looking for ways to, like, zhuzh it up. And through a series of events, she ends up jousting, despite the fact that there is a very sexist company policy that only men can joust. And then this whole thing goes behind with the feminist movement. We also find out the main character, she is super, super, super low income with her single mother and her brother, her deadbeat dad, who has addictions, is kind of geographically in the area, but they don't want him to be a part of their life, and he's doing this whole, like, oh, I found my life through Jesus, but then he won't pay child support because he wants them to find their way through Jesus too, and, like, holding it, and there's just a whole thing with them. I detest her father with every fiber of my being. Her uncle, I don't hate him as much as the father, but I don't feel like the book discussed enough of the fact of how much of a piece of garbage her uncle is, who's the boss at the Medieval Times joust thing. There's also this, like, douche guy jouster thing that really wants to be a jouster and is all like, yeah, sexism keeps them down, so I have a better chance of being a knight. Haha! And you're a bitch for not wanting to hook up with me. You know those kind of assholes? Yeah, so I was angry for a lot of the book, but I really, really liked the main character, and, like, I didn't grow up to that degree of poor, but I really comprehend, like, I can really, like, not sympathize, but, like, the fact that people, when they do grow up in those situations, and they can never seem to get a leg up in the world, especially in the United States, where, like, cost of healthcare and cost of education is just, like, an astronomical shit show. I don't understand how people live in that country. It's even more for me of, like, wow, like, I commend you for, like, yeah, I probably would have, like, at some point, you gotta be like, you know what, the world's an absolute shit. Why am I trying to be a good person anymore? You know what I mean? I also read Arusha and the Tree of Wishes. I think this is, this is the third book in the Padava series. I think I liked this more than book two, but not as much as book one. But I still really, really enjoyed this. I like the characters that always seem to get introduced. In this one, there's a set of twins who kind of get sort of, like, not kidnapped, but yeah, kidnapped. And of a foster system. And they're tied to different gods that we learn about. And it's this whole adventure. I love this series so much. It's so cute. I can't even imagine, like, the joy of getting to read this as, like, an Indian or a mixed race child for that target audience. I mean, I always got to read that as a kid. Like, I'm white, like, and I can't even imagine, like, the excitement now of being able to be like, oh my god, there's, after being only able to read, like, Anne of Green Gables, if people still read that, I don't know. Like, all the little children's books I think of, they're always predominantly white kids. And then finally being like, oh my god, there's an Indian child as the main character? Like, I can't even imagine the excitement of that. So, like, that just also warms my heart an awful lot. And I just found out, like, yesterday, apparently Roshni has an Audible exclusive story, like, coming out via audiobook in the next little while. It's on Audible. I just saw it yesterday and I freaked out and I was like, what the hell? I want it, I need it, I don't know what's happening. I also read The Queen of the Unwanted, which was so good. It's the sequel to Women's Wars. I still don't have my physical copy because the stores are still not open, and, like, it's just a hassle at this point to, like, cancel it and then reorder and then have it shipped to me because shipping has been an absolute shit show right now in Canada. It takes off exactly where Women's War ended, so I don't know that I can really say much without spoiling everything that happens at the end of Women's War, but there's this whole, like, discussion on, like, women's reproductive rights and the value of women when they're not, like, aesthetically pleasing, you know, when we don't have Facetune the way, like, Khloe Kardashian makes her look like she's an entirely different human at this point. It's very interesting, and then there's this conflict now of the women's well is landlocked, so how do they find allies, because the people that don't want them to become, like, a recognized principality are blocking off whenever they try and send, like, money or goods or whatever to potential allies to make deals. So there's this whole conflict, and there is another community that has, like, a woman in charge, so they're trying to find ways of those two girls connecting and keeping a strong relationship between the two that could benefit them, and it's really fantastic. I tweeted at the author, she said there's at least one more book coming, and I'm so excited. I tried to read The Henna Wars. I can't remember the author's name, sorry, it's totally skipping me. I love the cover so much. I got an hour in on the audiobook. It was the narration. I did not like the audiobook narrator whatsoever. I was struggling an awful lot, so I DNF'd that for now, and hopefully whenever libraries open, my library will eventually buy a copy and I could borrow it. I also read Serafina and the Black Cloak. This is the first book, and I think it's a quartet by Robert Beatty. I freaking love this, actually. I was not expecting to like it as much as I did. I think a couple people that I know that have read it had it like 3-ish stars, and I was like, aw, that's not great. But I read it. I freaking loved it. It was a pleasant surprise, a huge pleasant surprise. So the main character's father is like the electrician, essentially. Electricity is like a fairly new concept in this time period, but so he works and lives in this like estate manor, but like they hide and sleep in the basement because they can't really afford to or able to live anywhere else. But she's like not known to like the people who own the house, and all of a sudden she sees a bunch of kids are going missing, and she tries to track down why, because everyone doesn't believe her and she's the only one that sees the person in the black cloak doing it. And then she runs into the people who own the manor's son, and so he's kind of trying to figure out of like, why is no one else seeing this girl? Like, she's there. What's going on? Like, and he's a pretty good human being, and they want to try and find out where these children are going missing, because it's not just poor children that are being taken, it's people of like notice, like they have money, that their child is also going missing. So everyone's like on the hunt, especially at this manor, of like trying to find the children. But she, the little Serafina, is so cute, and she has a whole backstory of like the story of how she ended up with her dad and who her lineage is all revealed at the end. It's a really fun book. I really, really liked it. I'm glad I own the at least books 2 and 3 as well. Okay, and depending on how long this video is, this will be where we're cut off. So that is part one of the reviews. Let me know in the comment section down below if you've read any of these books, what your thoughts were. If you haven't, just what did you read this week? I'd love to know. And I will link these books in the description box down below. I will also link all of my social media. If you follow me, I will follow you back. And I will see you on Tuesday.